listening to the Why So Serious Show.
And now, stand up and make some noise
for your cast of the Why So Serious Show on BlazeRadioOnline.com.
Max, Matt, guess what I did today?
You went to a baseball game.
I did. Kind of talked to you guys off air about it.
Yes, you did.
But let me tell you, it felt so good. So I just wanted to go through the whole day. Kind of, we sat in the outfield, right? I'm going to make it short. We sat in the outfield. Everything was, you had to, the lines were spaced out 6 feet, so you walked in. I mean, I don't care. Like I at this point I would go to a full crowded stadium because I'm back.
You sat in a painted off box.
We sat in a painted off pod, but there was like 2,000 people there. It felt like a normal spring training game. There were roars of the crowd. There was booing. There was when something bad happened. I got 4 value hot dogs. Surprise Stadium, really good hot dog place. Really good hot dogs. Yeah, 4. They were tight. They're small.
Value hot dogs like $1, $2,
they were $3.
$3, not bad.
Then I got a $3 thing of peanuts and a $3 beer. So yeah, it was a good time. It was great being back in the ballpark. There was a billion home runs because the wind was blowing out straight towards center field and everything was carrying. If you guys really want to know something crazy, Billy Hamilton almost hit a home run. That's how much the wind was blowing out. And he ended up legging it out as a triple. But he came back to center field where he was playing, and everyone was giving him crap that he didn't hit it out. And I said, yeah, Billy, you got to hit it out. And he said, I know, I almost had that one. So, yeah, I communicated with a few of the players. I talked to Ben Gamble a little bit. I yelled at him that, so there was a no mask Nick running around, is what I called him. He was this little kid that no mask in sight. I don't know how the mask police missed him because there was a mask police. even though we're like 6 feet apart in our little, it was just me and Alex. Like it really would have been that bad if people had their masks off in the outfield. So that's for sure. But optics, you got to keep them on. And this little kid, no mask Nick, as I called him, he was getting toss up after toss up, and I motioned to Ben Gamble and I was like, hey, can I have a toss up, man? And then he gives it to the kid and I said, Ben, he's got 4 already, and Ben Gamble goes, sorry. Ben Gamble, by the way, was not enthused with the spring training game. Even though he's a non-roster invite that's trying to make the team, he like jogged for a double that was hit down the left field line because he was in left. I don't remember if he was on Cleveland or if he was on the Rangers. I think he was on Cleveland. But yeah, we saw some serious has-been players. We saw Chris Davis with a K. We saw Brock Holt was running around out there. tried to make a play and didn't make it. It would try to make a diving play at second base. Some guy in the stands in the over behind home plate yelled, "The Red Sox love you."
Yeah.
So yeah, it was an interesting experience. Did I already say that Drew Butera was the catcher for one of the teams?
No, you didn't. Also, how many innings were played?
All 9, but the top of the 9th inning, they just decided that Cleveland had scored too many runs, and so they just went back into the dugout after 1 out because their pitcher got hurt, which is not a laughing matter, but still, it was fun though. It was great to be back out there. It was $10 a ticket. Like, it was just great to be back out there at a ballpark.
Day of?
What did you say?
Like, when did you get the ticket? Was it day of or like a few days?
I got it on Saturday night.
Okay.
I bought them on Saturday night. Yeah, it was one of the most – honestly, it was the highlight of over a year for me. Like, even though I've covered games in person, it's kind of not the same as just going to a game as a fan where I felt safe where even if I wasn't vaccinated, I probably would have still felt safe. It's safer than going to the grocery store. Like, the amount of people that are wearing their mask below their nose, it's just like going to a grocery store. So, you know, I think if you do your part, you're going to be fine. And they're doing a good job of not overcrowding the stadiums. And so, yeah, and it wasn't even like sold to the point that they could have. Like, there
well,
was
the last time since we've done a elder edition of the Why So Serious show,
yes.
I actually went to a concert. Now, this concert was
a concert or a local music show?
It was a local music show, so I'll explain it. So, one of our morning anchors, Saving, was the MC. It was a group called David Perico and the Pop Strings Orchestra, who used to perform at Caesar's Palace. They were performing out of this small venue. There were 44 of us in the crowd. We were all spaced out at tables, like four at a table, obviously wearing our masks when not drinking. There was also, and this was what they called the stupidest rule that they actually just changed last week. There was legitimately 25 feet between the first row of tables and the stage.
I like that rule, actually. It's a good rule.
Well, they changed it last week to make it 12 feet because they thought 25 feet was way too many feet apart. But it was a great show. It was a tribute to Black History Month. They played a lot of great hits. It was a lot of fun. It was only 2 hours, but it was a great 2-hour show. And you know, it was great to be back in person at an event. I don't know when the next event I'll be going to will be. My dad is trying, I'm going to be going home for Easter. So my dad's trying to get me and him tickets to one of the Phillies games that weekend when they host the Braves for opening weekend. So I'm excited about that.
Still not signed. How about that? Nick Markakis is a really good player. He's actually my favorite baseball player of all time. Which, again, that's most people's reaction is what Max just did there. He was such a good professional player.
Okay, because last season was so fast and so fussy, did Markakis play for the Braves?
Yes, he originally opted out, then he decided, oh, they're really good, and I kind of want to come back. And now nobody has signed him, and it's made me sad. But he didn't have his best year last year. But
I'm gonna offer this hot take again in a few weeks. I think the Braves peaked. And
wow.
Yeah.
I like that. That means good things for the Cardinals.
Yep. It means good things for every other team in the National League besides the Dodgers.
Speaking of baseball, I mean, we've got fans in the stands for all 30 teams. You know, it could be just like the gradual return to normalcy, just watching baseball. I think that's kind of just how we've always kind of gotten back to normal in this country, is by watching baseball. How excited are you for an actual baseball season this year with your team? It's supposed to be amazing.
I'm actually super excited because obviously, like, back in the pool stays and stuff, I was really into the Cardinals. I mean, I would say 100 some games a year. It wasn't the kind of thing where I watched every single game, but I at least like caught parts of the high majority of games, watched every playoff game and stuff. And then, you know, the Cardinals, I mean, the Cardinals have never been bad in my lifetime, but you know, their down seasons are, oh, they're a wild card team or something like that. But yeah, I didn't really watch them much. And then last year, cause there's nothing else to do, I watched like almost every game they play. I bet I watched 50 games of theirs during the regular season last year, watched every playoff game and stuff. So now with an actual season, now that they have Arenado also, I'm like super excited for baseball this year. Like, I can't wait. I've got the MLB extra innings on my computer and stuff. I can't wait to watch them. I'm planning on watching almost every game that I can, at least. So
this is music to my ears from Max, because like, you know, This was the friend of mine that left early of baseball games and was just like,
I'm so glad I left that one. The longest game in Diamondbacks history. Yeah, I'm so glad I left
that just because of the experience. But I think Max was already done with long games. He stayed at the 9-inning ASU game that was like 4 hours.
I root for the home team no matter who. Like, even if the Cardinals are playing on the road, I root for the home team so they don't have to have a bottom of the ninth.
Yeah.
Best game I've ever been to. I've said this before. It was a couple of years ago. Cubs-Cardinals.
Please don't tell me you root. This is terrible.
No. Okay, so this was the week of when the Blues were in the Stanley Cup. I went to the Stanley Cup game, and I went to a Cubs-Cardinals game. That week in St. Louis was insane with the Stanley Cup in town and Cubs-Cardinals in town the same weekend. That town was buzzing. But so anyway, the Cubs-Cardinals game, final score was 2-1. There was like 4 total hits in the game. The game was like 2 hours and 15 minutes. It was in and out. It was amazing. It was so good.
Pitcher's duel. Like good defense in football.
Yeah. Wainwright pitched like 8 innings, gave up 1 hit, 1 run. Like, it was great. It was like, at the time, it was thought that he might like retire at the end of the season. So it kind of felt like a great, like, oh, this is probably my last time seeing Wainwright. Like, that's awesome.
Yes. Yes. This is golden.
Red hole. Legend.
I don't know if I can laugh at this or just be sad for him or some of both.
What?
But here you go.
He was living his best life.
I don't even know if he's 50 in this.
Red Hole's 56, by the way.
Okay. I'm just going to say that I think that the Stanley Cup in 18 and 19 back-to-back had the two best parades of all time.
The Caps and
Capitals
Blues.
And the Blues were just insane.
Okay, that is the drunkest thing you can say.
Have you seen like all the videos though? Like, he was just like roaming the streets of St. Louis the night they won, like with like beers in his hands. Just like, he was like legitimately drunk for like 2 weeks over this. Brett Hull was.
Yeah, I hope he's okay. That's my thing with it. That we didn't even get to the best part there where he's.
Gloria.
But like, that's how like most people were in that town. Like, a lot of people think of St. Louis, rightfully so, as a baseball city. I mean, St. Louis is all about baseball. It's all about the Cardinals, but the Blues are a big deal there. I mean the Cardinals have always been tough to get tickets to. They've always been expensive tickets, one of the most expensive tickets in all of baseball. Like, the Blues have kind of been like more of the working class team there for years. Like, that's who a lot of people like really, really love in St. Louis. And so like them winning the Stanley Cup for the first time ever in 50 years, I mean, that was like huge for the city. Like, everybody was just on cloud nine, including Brett Hull, clearly.
I'm now the Clydesdales parade into opening day at the Cardinals game, because we've watched it on this elder edition of the West show.
It's like such a cliche talking about how great of a baseball city St. Louis is, but it really is. Like,
it's
there's
a football town, let's be real.
But like, I've been to Yankees games, I've been to Red Sox games, I've been to Cubs games, I've been to a Dodgers game. Legitimately, nothing has the feel of going to a baseball game in St. Louis.
What about a good game at Chase?
It's a cliche at this point, but
I don't know what,
if
like
they're playing the Cardinals, there'd probably be more Cardinals fans there, which tells me.
Now nobody cares about the Phillies in Philly, like, for the most part.
Yeah, I always think of Philly as a football town. And now it's like getting basketball a little bit, I feel like. Like, I feel like the 76ers now that they're really good.
Yeah, I mean, we've always liked our basketball, whether it be the Sixers or our colleges. Shout out Drexel University Dragons, the champs of the CAA. They're going dancing next week. My dad's a spotter.
That's the best college basketball town.
Shout out Wilt Chamberlain for not actually scoring 100 points.
I want to go to a game at the Palestra so badly.
Yeah, the Palestra is like the cathedral of basketball.
That's on my bucket list.
Nobody's gonna comment on what I just said.
What? Yeah, I heard.
Oh, you scored like 40 points, but the radio guy like messed it up.
No, there wasn't even. I don't even think there was no media in attendance.
That's the story. That's the story. Is that the radio guy messed it up, and then everybody just went with it that he scored 100 points.
Oh, okay. Well, what I've heard is that there was no media there. There was only like 4,000 fans. You know.
Yeah, there was barely anyone there. Like,
it was also Hershey.
I get it. Like, he like averaged like 50-20 in a season. Like,
yeah, he was really good. But do it in the finals.
Honestly, he'd age better than any player pre-Magic in today's NBA.
But no, here's my thing though. Wilt Chamberlain lost to a 6'9" guy that couldn't play on offense.
Yeah. You know, he lost to Joel Anthony. Bill Russell is Joel Anthony.
Joel, it's such a bad take.
It's the truth. I'm sorry.
But yeah.
Would you rather me say Kendrick Perkins?
Kendrick Perkins, you know.
Iced his knees after not playing a single minute in a finals game.
Jacked in a full Hall of Famer.
Yeah. Up there with, you know, JaVale McGee obviously is the GOAT of Shaqt and a Fool. Brandon Knight is an all-time great for Shaqt and a Fool.
Swaggy P.
Perkins is up there. Swaggy P, definitely. J.R. Smith a little bit. But
LeBron has had a good amount of moments.
Just because he touches the ball more than anybody else in the NBA.
I just like when Kendrick Perkins decided he was a point guard. And then just threw the ball out of bounds. It was such a good moment. You know what? I actually witnessed a JaVale McGee Shaqt and a Fool moment in person.
Good.
So we went on a school field trip to see Wizards Nuggets. And JaVale was on the Nuggets at the time. And JaVale decides that he's going to play point guard on a fast break. And he takes it down the floor and just like charges down, just like fumbles and falls and just falls over himself and falls over the ball and it goes out of bounds. And I was like, that's going to end up on Shaqt and a Fool. Like a week later, it was on Shaqt and a Fool.
Do you want to hear another take? I don't know if it's a hot take because I think it's 100% true. And I don't know if it can be really debated. JaVale McGee is a top five greatest athlete to ever play in the NBA. Like when you combine like his athleticism with his size, like he should be the greatest player to ever play basketball. It's just he is like such a goofball out there.
He might be the top five lowest in coordination in NBA history, but has top five athleticism.
I got introduced to him because when I went to high school, like I was a casual NBA fan. Like I watched like Cavs games and that's pretty much it. But I got introduced to JaVale McGee because he and Swaggy P at the time had a YouTube channel together.
That was great.
Where they would just go to like Benihana and have like rap battles and stuff. And so my buddy who was super into the NBA used to show me Pierre and Swaggy P's videos.
So back when Max and I thought that Anthony Edwards was going to suck, I mean, he kind of is.
I mean, he's not very good. Like, let's just be honest here right now.
Well, I don't know how substantiated this claim is, but apparently, like, he went out to a Benihana or something for, like, some pre-draft or I don't know what, whatever it was, but he brought his own. He brought his own food, thinking that you brought your own food to a Benihana and just had them prepare it for you. I don't know if this is true, but it's a story I heard.
Should I put something on the poll about this?
What?
I said, should I put something on the poll about this? Like,
put on the poll. Do you bring your own food to Benihana and expect to cook it for you? Or do you realize that it's an actual restaurant?
I actually found the video of them having a rap battle at Benihana. I'm so glad I didn't imagine that this existed. All right.
So, do I need to share the screen? Do we need to watch this, Max?
Probably not a great idea. Let's just be honest here.
Anthony Edwards. 37% from the field.
It's the dunk of the year, though.
30%, yeah, and a loss where he was like 2 for 9. Do it on the court. He takes 6 threes a game, but is shooting 30%. But he might want to stop taking threes. 81%.
By the way, JaVale's had some really nice moments for the Cavs this year.
He's on the Cavs?
Yeah, he's on the Cavs. He's the backup center.
To Jared Allen.
Yeah, Jared Allen. Jared Allen, like, had a 5-game stretch where he was basically putting up Wilt numbers.
Cavs still have a higher likelihood of winning the finals than the Bucks.
Jared Allen had, like, a stretch where he had, like, gone, like, 10 for 11, 9 for, like, 12, 11 for 12, like, all in a row from the field. Like, it was ridiculous.
He's averaging 14.9 points per game, 4 rebounds. That's one of the least efficient 14.9. He's shooting 6 of 15. He's shooting 5.5 of 14.9 from the field.
Who?
Anthony Edwards.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, they're going to get I'm blanking on his name. The guy from Oklahoma State who's going to be the next LeBron.
Cade Cunningham.
He's going to be the next LeBron.
I love how you tweeted the Drexel men's basketball Twitter account. The non-verified Drexel men's basketball Twitter account with 3,870 followers. No wonder they haven't made the tournament in 10 years.
Watch Cade Cunningham's highlights, though, and tell me he doesn't scream next LeBron. He does.
Cade Cunningham.
He's good.
Oklahoma State might be the worst with fans in the entire country. They have so many fans at their basketball games. Them and GCU.
Because I've watched a few of their games for Cade Cunningham, and yeah, it's not great for fans.
Oh, I'm saying like too many fans during COVID.
Yeah.
Hey, I'd like you to whip out the fact of the day sound because
it says Travis, but
I don't care. But this is actually a fun fact of the day that I just found out. So right, go ahead, find that sound.
Let me see if I even have it anymore. That's the intro. Yeah, we got it right here.
The fact of the day. We want it now. The fact of the day.
Max hated that when he first heard it.
I love it, and I love this fact of the day. Drexel basketball's tournament appearance is their first since 1996. 1996, also the year I was born.
Me too.
Wow. I was born in 98.
I legit thought they had made the tournament like 15 years ago, but they hadn't. It was...
Well, Jesse, by the way, you do realize that this... poll doesn't make sense, right? Was it supposed to not make sense?
Kling put it on the poll. That wasn't me.
Because you said you asked an either or and you put the options as yes or no.
Yeah, again,
Kling, I don't know how to vote on it.
Hey, you don't get the show, okay? Because you know, back.
Wait, hold on. Kling just wants to be lazy and not put that back on the poll again. So he's saying that we're just going to roll with it for funny show purposes instead of the actual poll that was funnier. So I can explain that right there. How about that? Kling, no, Cody.
No. Hold on. I'm just doing what our polls were on Matt to Matt with Al Kendon. As in, a legit question and then yes or no. You're lucky I didn't put like some funny options like I did on Sunday, which even though I know we're going way out of order, I'd like to go over the polls that I posted on Sunday because some of them were
yesterday. I guess that should get deleted though, so it's fine.
What's that? Yeah, because
you know, Blaze Radio.
Yeah, so I'm gonna go look through. Here we go. So can you not like a nice old man? 62% of the audience said no. Who were we talking about? Joe Biden. We were talking about the president because he's an old man.
He might be the oldest old man of all old men ever.
Yeah, it's true. Are NASCAR green flag pit stops lame? 63% of voters said yes. Anyone going to watch NBA All-Star? Okay, did anyone here watch it? Because I didn't.
I watched the last two minutes.
I
slept through the game. The three-point shootout was awesome. It was the worst dunk contest I've ever seen.
Okay,
dunk was nice, though. That dunk over Shaq was nice.
The kiss dunk was awful.
I didn't see a single dunk other than the one over Shaq where he hung in the rim then. And I was like, oh, that's really nice. There wasn't a better dunk, I can guarantee it. So I didn't
know. Okay. And Fernie Simons tried to kiss the rim and didn't kiss the rim.
Okay. There was a poll that got 33 votes. Do you care about the Royals, aka Harry and Meghan? 45% of those who voted said no. 33% Meghan. Said yes. And 22% said 2015 Mary. World champs. Because the Royals were 2015 world champs.
Yep.
By the way, did anyone else watch that interview? Because I did.
I'm 20 minutes in.
I'm not interested, but I know the Buckingham Palace kind of gave out a quick statement today, basically saying, yeah, we feel bad for them. Like,
and there's a drive to deep left field by Castellanos, and
yeah,
that'll be a home run, and it'll be a 4-0 yeah. ball game.
By the way, if you do the math, it was about 20% of UK's population actually watched the interview, which aired a day after it aired in the US. And also somehow people were able to watch the US version of it and they caught a glimpse of all the commercials, most in particular, the commercials for prescription drugs. And they were like, what? So apparently in the UK, prescription drug commercials are banned, which is pretty interesting. Because honestly, if you turn on TV besides watching sports, you're going to get stuck seeing a commercial for like Xarelto or Nugenix or something.
Nugenix a prescription drug or is it just Frank Thomas?
I'm putting that on the poll. It's not a prescription drug. I just randomly said that,
on the poll. Is Frank Thomas and are Frank Thomas and his Nugenix going to come and steal your wife?
Are Frank Thomas and his Nugenix going to come and steal your wife?
I'll tell you, they saw a lot of those commercials because that was my biggest issue with the broadcast of that was there was a commercial every 3 minutes of interview time. Like for every 3 minutes of interview, there was another commercial.
They had to afford Oprah.
Yeah.
I was just sitting there like, oh my God. Like,
you know when this commercial's gonna end? You know how much Oprah made for an interview with just a random ass family that doesn't do anything anymore? $6 million. $6 or $7 million.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the thing. That interview,
Alex was like, you get an interview. Okay.
That interview drew more people than the Golden Globes and quite
surprising.
Yeah, because Jesse and I were the only ones who watched the Golden Globes.
Now, could it outdraw the Grammys? I don't know, but I'm going to get into Grammys picks in a little bit, but honestly, I want to hear movie talk for a few before we get to Grammy talk.
This is movie talk. It's Golden Globes talk. So Tina Thompson and Maya Rudolph, they just came out on stage because, you know, they're part of NBC. I guess Maya Rudolph is paid by SNL.
I guarantee there is no script to that. They just said, hey, go be funny.
Like, they weren't really funny. It was just weird.
It was very weird. It was definitely it was the kind of thing that you laugh at just because you're so uncomfortable with how unfunny it is. And so, like, it kind of comes back to work. Like, I don't know if you saw that one that Will Ferrell and Kristen Wiig did a few years ago where they're, like, trying to, like, finish each other's sentences and stuff. Terrible. Like, it's the same thing where it's so uncomfortable because it's not funny that it becomes funny. And that's what the Kenan Thompson, Maya Rudolph thing.
That was just kind of the entire night. It was, like, Zoom problems. You just had Jason Sudeikis in his hoodie. Like, it was
the... Hold up, Don Cheadle get from the...
Yeah, Don Cheadle. And they cut to Don Cheadle every single time. Like, Don Cheadle got so much screen time on that show.
It's so funny, too, because Don Cheadle's probably, like, the 20th Avenger.
Yeah, like Don Cheadle's like that generic person who it's like he doesn't cost that much, but he's still a big star. Hotel Rwanda's great, by the way.
Who's the guy that's also in those movies that kind of look Jeremy Renner? He's also that actor.
See, here's the thing though, Jeremy Renner was like a huge like prestige movie guy before going into the Avengers movies, and now he's not known as a prestige actor at all. Like he was like nominated for Oscars like 2 years in a row, like leading up to the Avengers. Like he was nominated for The Town, he was nominated for The Hurt Locker, which won Best Picture. Like he was like this huge prestige actor, and then he went into the Marvel movies, and now like everybody just thinks of him as a guy who shoots bow and arrows.
Yeah, but he's also like not even in those. He's like Don Cheadle. He's like in those movies for 5 minutes.
Yeah, and he plays like the most useless Avenger. It's like you've got a guy who can literally snap his fingers and like wipe out half the population, and he's sitting there with a bow and arrow.
Like, it's like Aquaman. What does Aquaman actually do?
Oh, Aquaman actually is like has powers. Like
yeah, Aquaman, the new has, like, Aquaman. We're talking about like 60s Aquaman in the Adam West Batman cartoon.
He still had strength.
He makes a sandwich because he can't do shit. Do you get that?
No.
Frank Caliendo does like a limit. He does like a fake like 60s TV show announcer guy. He goes, Aquaman is making himself a sandwich because he can't do shit.
Aquaman actually has some powers. I mean, he talks to fish. Like that comes in handy.
Yeah, shark, go jump out of the water and snatch somebody's arm. How about that?
That's the thing about, like, when people talk about the Marvel versus DC debates, is, like, DC...
You doing okay over there, Max?
What?
You doing okay over there?
Yeah. Like, DC has some great heroes with, like, Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman, but they also have some, like, really stupid and shitty ones. Like Aquaman. Like, it's just, like...
Like Captain America.
What?
Like Captain America.
Well, Captain America's Marvel.
I'm just saying that. Captain America is just in general is a stupid superhero.
I mean, he's got super strength.
Yeah, but he fights with a shield.
Hey, that shield's made of vibranium.
Yeah, but this is America. We don't fight with shields. We charge. We put our military in literally every country. It makes no sense that he fights with a damn shield.
Anyway, you said you had movie stuff, right?
I do, and then I know you do. But my stuff is. First off, I've become a documentary, like, I'm watching them all. I'm trying to watch them all.
Time. Watch the documentary Time. I think it costs a couple bucks on Amazon, but watch
it. I'm on the HBO Max train.
Actually, I think Time is free on Amazon. If anyone wants an Amazon login, let me know.
Okay.
That's the best documentary I've ever watched in my life.
All of our viewers will be texting you.
That's fine. If it gets them to watch Time, that's fine.
Okay, so yeah, what is it about, by the way?
It's about
time.
It's really depressing. It's about this guy who falsely goes on death row, and it's about his wife, like, films their children's lives for, like, 20 years. years while he's like falsely on death. He does get released, but it's about her like filming her children's lives and like her children like all grow up to be really, really successful, really, really like well-adjusted people and stuff. And while their father is in prison, like it's absolutely incredible. It's fascinating. It's like, it's only like an hour and 20 minutes. It's amazing.
Oh, I love a good short documentary.
It's real quick, but it's really good.
But
probably the best documentary this year at the Oscars. Okay,
so do you want me to start off with, actually, none of these are very positive. I'm just going to say that.
Documentaries are.
So just them. So I watched The Scheme on HBO Max. It's about the Christian Dawkins, like, college basketball FBI recruiting thing.
Yeah.
What he did or what the universities did, whatever, it doesn't make any sense. Like, I was so confused the entire time. I don't know if it was the documentary, but it just doesn't make any sense. And no, the FBI did not have any way of take, like, they just couldn't take down these coaches because they just are too powerful. And there was also, like, you know, like, the only reason they're able to get involved is because it involved like bribing and public officials, because coaches at universities are technically public officials that work for the government. So therefore that's what like, that is what like the whole thing was trying to do. And like, they've done nothing. And also like the, one of the FBI agents like didn't handle funds properly, but, and also this guy that is like, ended up being like the scapegoat for everyone, Christian Dawkins, he's like 25. just watch this documentary. It's bizarre. You can't, like, I highly recommend it, and it might be the worst documentary I've ever seen. The most poorly, sloppily put together thing that makes no sense, but I highly recommend it. Just because I just want Max or Kling or somebody to explain to me what actually went on, because I just don't understand it. But the best part of it is probably at the end when you hear Sean Miller basically just openly say, we want to pay this guy. That's a good one. That's a good part. And Will Wade as well, former VCU coach.
Isn't he the American gangster Will Wade? Isn't that his John Rothstein thing?
American gangster Will
Wade. I believe it's American gangster Will Wade.
It's true.
It's fitting.
It's like the college basketball landscape, men's college basketball landscape is the mafia.
Oh, it's so corrupt.
It's so bad. Like, it's just pay them. Like, I don't really think that college athletes should be paid like salaries, but at this point they should. Like, where we are with this, it's like just ridiculous. Like, just pay them so that this doesn't happen. Like, have you guys heard about this ridiculous college, like, high school pro league? Like, all these kids are going to declare for the high school pro league, and then they're going to not be any good, and they're not going to go to the league, they're not going to have any education, and they're just going to be like, just, what are people doing? It's just sports. Like, I don't understand. But yeah, there's that.
What else did you watch?
Yeah, watch that. I watched The Way Back with
yes, so good,
with Ben Affleck. It's maybe Ben Affleck's best performance.
Oh yes, absolutely, it is so good. That was the last movie I saw in theater before quarantine. Last movie I saw in theater before quarantine.
I'm not gonna spoil it, but there are
don't spoil it. It's definitely one to go into blind. Yeah,
there are some very funny moments. There are some very sad moments. There are some like heartbreaking moments.
I cried during it.
I don't think I cried, but there's you go through a whole range of emotions there, and it's not really an inspirational sports movie, which is different. It kind of is, but watch that.
What I like about The Way Back is it takes like all these sports cliches, and just when you think it's going to fully go for it, it goes completely away from it. Like that's what I like about it, is it does play on cliches, but it completely subverts like you.
It's the only complaint that I had about it, a little Hoosiers-esque, a little bit.
It doesn't
go full Hoosiers, so we're fine. Yeah. And then I have been watching, good God, Allen versus Pharaoh, and it is absolutely awful. And Woody Allen is a creep.
Yeah.
By the way, so something that allegedly a creep. But like the thing with Woody Allen that I didn't understand before, like I'd always known that he was like big on putting older men with younger women in movies, but I never knew it was like underage young. Like this Manhattan movie that was heralded by
Murder Mystery, yeah.
The critics need to be held accountable for some of this. And like the fact that that was like, and it was like a weird thing where he would like manipulate the situation with the script where it was showing that it was like kind of her fault that she was in this relationship. And so it's just like, no, like I never knew that it went to the level of 42-year-old with 17-year-old creepy.
Yeah. And obviously this one isn't like to that level, but even recently movie Irrational Man came out. I loved that movie. I watched it. And then when you like recontextualize it with everything, it's like, God, that movie is so creepy. I mean, it's got like, cause it's Joaquin Phoenix and Emma Stone. They don't have that big of an age difference in real life, but in the context of the movie, they do, like, cause Emma Stone plays younger than she is and Joaquin Phoenix plays older than he is. And like the way that like Joaquin Phoenix's character kind of manipulates her, but like, it's like all like brought back to like, oh, like he was the good guy the whole time. It's like, that's really weird and stuff.
Yeah. So my take is that Woody Allen seriously has some serious issues. And instead of going to therapy and trying to address those issues, he has instead acted on those issues. And this is what I believe, because I believe Mia Farrow and the whole Soon-Yi thing is super weird too.
Very, very weird.
And because like
that was like the first thing that got people really thinking, like, oh wow, this is really
she wasn't actually his stepdaughter, but it was close to that. And the creepiest thing about it is that he knew her when she was like 10. So, and I mean, they're married for 25 years and have two kids, so I'm gonna lean the side of he is definitely a creep just based off of his movies. I think the movies indict him on what he is. I think the movies are self-aware.
Yeah, I don't disagree.
I think he tries to normalize that behavior in the movies that he makes. And while he has definitely made some classics that you can't deny are classics, I think that Woody Allen at this point in his life at 85 years old should not be allowed to make another movie.
Yeah. And it's kind of like the opposite situation of Tarantino, because, you know, obviously Tarantino has his issues. Tarantino has a lot of people that don't like him. But what I always say about Tarantino is the bad guys are the bad guys and the good guys are the good guys. And it's very clear while watching the movie that he roots for the good people in the movie. And Woody Allen is kind of the opposite, where almost always the most unlikable character is the hero of the story.
Yeah, it's a very interesting, and yeah, it's just a very interesting but scary thing. And I feel bad for the kids that were involved. Obviously, I feel bad for Mia Farrow, who really, really, really loved Woody Allen. And that's what it comes out, that she loved Woody Allen and she rooted for Woody Allen and she wanted Woody Allen to change some of the precursor bad behavior that he ended up, you know, going a level further with. And so, but yeah, it's creepy. And
the power of 70s Hollywood is really fascinating, and not like specifically 70s Hollywood, but the people who became power players in 70s Hollywood is really fascinating, because it goes like one of two ways. Like you got people like Spielberg and George Lucas, and you know, that have never had a single thing like about them. But then you've got like the opposite with people like Woody Allen and Roman Polanski, who just allegedly were not good people and are not good people. And Roman Polanski
isn't allowed back in the United States.
Yeah, right? Roman Polanski is like a fugitive in the United States. Yeah. But yeah, so like it's interesting to examine the power dynamic of 70s Hollywood, because so many, like,
did Weinstein get
the all-time greatest director?
Did Weinstein get big in 70s?
I would say Weinstein was more 90s. Weinstein really became big with like Kevin Smith and Quentin Tarantino movies originally. That was when he became Weinstein.
Yeah, did his brother have some stuff too?
Not as much as Harvey, but there's stuff with the Weinsteins just in general. Just even with how they played their power and stuff.
Yeah, it's really bad. It is. They are the worst as far as, or not they. I shouldn't say they, because Bob is probably not in that.
Not as bad.
But as far as Harvey Weinstein is up there with like the Larry Nassars of the world and those.
Yeah, like, absolutely. And it's really an interesting situation, because a lot of A-list actors really became A-list actors because of Harvey Weinstein. Yep. I mean, you know.
There's some people. What do you have, Max?
Wait, hold on. Can I interject before going to your list? I didn't essay this like I normally do, but I watched the documentary about Britney Spears.
Oh, so good.
That is so good. I never realized how she was portrayed in the public eye, how basically everyone treated her like garbage. The fact that she could barely go anywhere without 20 cameras in her face was ridiculous, which, you know, and the fact that, you know, back, you know, 12 years ago, 13 years ago, 14 years ago, we weren't necessarily moving to normalize mental health and prioritizing mental health as we are today. And clearly she had mental health issues. You know, everything that went on affected her mental health. Unfortunately, now the story, which was kind of the basis of the whole New York Times documentary, was the fact that she can't technically like write out a check, use her own, pay off her own bills, or even choose her own healthcare in a serious, but as they say, flawed thing called the conservatorship, which has been the focus of Britney Spears' life for the past couple of years, as she's trying to not make her father, who was kind of a hands-off-ish person until she got sick. You know, her father is her conservator. She wants a bank to be her conservator, and still to this day, her father's still her conservator, which is
it's really sad too, because basically Britney Spears' dad didn't really care about her and just wanted her to make money for him so he could buy a boat.
Yeah. Literally, so like
literally what he says.
Yeah. My quick take on this whole thing is like Britney Spears, you realize after her breakdown, she released the Circus album. And, you know, I remember Circus album had Womanizer, Circus. You may remember this song, If You Seek Amy. Which is, if you watch the music video, it's really funny. Fox News made fun of that song because I'll repeat the title one more time, not too fast, but it's If You Seek Amy. If you say real fast like she does in the song, it spells out a curse word. And the music video actually kind of if you look it up, makes fun of her sort of, not really makes fun, but she acknowledges how like she's portrayed and what she goes through, which I wish they included that in the documentary because it was crazy. But again, right after her breakdown, she puts out new music. She has a whole freaking residency in Vegas. She almost has a second one, cancels that. But yeah, the fact that Britney Spears is still under her father's watch is somewhat ridiculous.
She's like 40 years old, 39 years old now.
She has kids. Yeah.
It's like, yeah, just like she's honestly, she's done pretty well for herself, and she's
done very well.
It's also like people are like, oh, Britney Spears on drugs, but I don't even sure if she ever did drugs. Like,
oh,
I don't know if this goes into it, but like, didn't her like niece almost like die like at like age like 8 or something in like this big accident and stuff?
I don't know.
Like, I don't think I'm imagining that. Like, Jamie Lynn Spears' daughter like almost like died, like was in the hospital for like months.
Oh yeah,
in, like, I critical condition. Yeah, like that's yeah. Like just like all the stuff that's happened in her life and stuff. That's
yeah. Like, I mean, you know, she's just. You know, it was just a bit ridiculous what the paparazzi did to her. And, you know, I think that we're good. I think that, you know, while I don't like a lot of social media, I think social media is good when, you know, like when an 18-year-old Billie Eilish is a little bit, you know, heftier than some people in like sweatpants, and somebody writes a story about how she's like a little bit more, you know, overweight than certain other celebrities, and not saying that she is overweight, like she's fine. And people on, you know, Twitter are like, oh, she looks fine. Like, stop being mean to her. Like, I think that people are for the most part pretty good at doing that these days, and not like making sure, I mean, kind of just making sure that like people are not treated like Britney Spears was treated. So I think that's true. But Max, your movies.
All right, so I did see some movies this week, but none of them really worth talking about. I mean, I watched the new SpongeBob movie. It's funny. It's SpongeBob. There's nothing really to say about it. There's some really great nods to, like, the classic days of the TV show. Like, if you watch the TV show, you'll pick up on some stuff that you really enjoy and stuff. But it's a SpongeBob movie. I mean, it's fun. It's not...
Patrick!
It's not good with... It's not going to win any awards, but it's really fun and stuff. Like, I saw something like that. I saw the Mauritanian. Yeah. I saw the Mauritanian, which is kind of an Oscar baity type movie, has a chance for some awards, but it's fine. But the Oscars are coming up on Tuesday. The announcement for the nominations are. This is probably be our last show before then. So I'm going to lock in my predictions for the Above the Line category. So if people aren't familiar, Above the Line means the important categories.
The Sponge on the Run level category.
Yes, the Sponge on the Run level category. So I'll start with Best Film Editing, which is one of the strongest indicators for Best Picture. So the nominees, I believe, will be The Trial of the Chicago 7, Nomadland, Mank, Sound of Metal, and Promising Young Woman.
Coming.
Yep. Now, and by the way, these are all ranked in the order that I think the likelihood they are nominated. For Best Cinematography, Nomadland, Mank, Minari, Judas and the Black Messiah, and News of the World. For Best Original Screenplay, I have The Trial of the Chicago 7, Promising Young Woman,
Homan,
Mank, Minari, and Sound of Metal. For Best Adapted Screenplay, I have Nomadland, One Night in Miami, Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. Now, here's an interesting one here. Borat Subsequent Movie Film and The Father.
Can you please give the entire name of Borat Subsequent Movie Film whenever you say it, please?
I don't remember it off the top of my head, but...
Can you look it up?
For Best Supporting Actor... I have Daniel Kaluuya for Judas and the Black Messiah. I would almost venture to say Daniel Kaluuya is a lock to win Best Supporting Actor.
Okay, Daniel Kaluuya, cool name, but it kind of also makes me think of, which is really bad because I know he's such a good actor, and this guy
best is... Best actor of his generation.
Yeah, you say he's the best actor of this generation, and this is such an insult to him, but it makes me think Dave Coulier.
I can see that. Yeah,
it makes me think Dave Coulier.
Pretty soon, when you think of Dave Coulier, you'll think of Daniel Kaluuya because he's the best actor of this generation.
Hopefully, because we don't need any more. Cut it out.
Out.
Okay. By the way, whenever you say, I will give the full name of Borat Subsequent Movie Film. Right.
I've got one more nomination for it. So yes. So be ready for it. All right. Daniel Kaluuya, he's almost a lock to win for best supporting actor.
Best supporting actor. Imagine that.
For Judas and the Black Messiah. Judas and the Black Messiah, the best movie that is eligible for Oscars this year, in my opinion. So then, other nominees for Best Supporting Actor, Sacha Baron Cohen, not for Borat, but for The Trial of the Chicago 7. Leslie Odom Jr., not for Hamilton, but for One Night in Miami. Chadwick Boseman, not for Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, but for The Five Bloods. And then Paul Racy for Sound of Metal.
Settle.
Okay, for Best Supporting Actress, get ready, Matt.
All right.
Maria Bakalova for...
Borat's subsequent movie film delivery of prodigious bribe to American regime for make benefit once glorious nation of Kazakhstan.
The movie with that title is going to win an Oscar because Maria Bakalova, I am ready to say it, she is winning Best Supporting Actress for this movie. I honestly believe she's going to.
You know what Borat winning awards is? It's like when I do something like really good.
What, like win a Wally?
Yeah, when I do some like serious journalism and like get an award for it, like at the end of the day, it's me doing that. So like,
or like, maybe getting nominated for an Emmy, or and possibly winning an Emmy.
Yeah, it's kind of anybody on the show other than Max, because Max is just somewhat professional. Like,
I mean, I'm professional.
Jeremy's doing a story. Let me digress a little bit here. Jeremy's doing a story because he's doing a series of stories on him learning how to do certain sports. So yeah. It's like cheerleading. Jeremy got tossed in the air by high school cheerleaders.
Oh gosh.
And then he's also he did a cartwheel and then he tried to do a forward roll apparently and like rolled over his shoulder and he dropped the mic. So again, it's like when one of us does something other than Max doing something, because
like learn instruments in the marching band, like play a tuba or play bass or play like an air drum.
What instrument in the marching band would Jeremy represent? I feel like it's either oboe or tuba.
Cymbals.
I'm gonna put this on the poll. I'm gonna put four options on the poll. What instrument in a marching band would Jeremy represent?
It's gotta be oboe, tuba, cymbals, and
can I just say bass guitar?
Like the guy on the sideline that plays the bass.
Yeah.
Say bass guitar in the pit is what it's called. It's called the pit because my brother was a band kid in high school.
Okay, so we got oboe. Matt
loves the Wisconsin band.
Wisconsin band's great.
Don't they almost get kicked out of like every game?
They had to stop traveling for a couple years.
I like the Stanford band, not the football one, the basketball pet band, and the tree. The tree, the unofficial mascot that's verified on Twitter.
Yeah.
Okay, right. So hold on. We're going oboe, cymbals. What else? Guitar, tuba, and then
bass guitar in the pit.
Bass guitar.
Should it be bass guitar in the pit or xylophone in the pit?
I say bass guitar.
Bass guitar is kind of, never mind. I'm not going to say that. I know a very prominent bassist in Nashville. I'm not going to throw myself under the bus there.
All right. Anyway. If Maria Bakalova were to win, she'd have to beat out one of the greatest actresses of all time because Jodie Foster is my second most likely to be nominated for the Mauritanian.
Foster. So,
Jodie Foster, the only thing standing in her way from a third Oscar trophy is somebody from Borat. So that's fun. I wish I could describe some of the stuff she does in the movie, but it would be too inappropriate for the show.
This show is not, since when are we BG?
Oh, this is NC-17 almost level stuff.
Okay, then go for it. I think we've talked about pretty much everything on here.
Said if you seek Amy today, so go ahead.
I've been trying to run that through my head and no.
Do I play the clip of the song for you?
Yes, I want to hear it.
All right. Max, do your thing first, and then I'll play the song.
Anyway, So best supporting actress. So then third most likely is Amanda Seyfried, who's a great actress, and she's finally getting some recognition for it in a crappy movie, Mank. Then
Mank is dank.
Sorry, David Fincher, but it's a crappy movie. It's David Fincher's worst movie. Anyway, then Yoo Jung-yoon, I hope I'm not butchering that name, for Minari. She gives one of the best performances of the year. It's hopefully going to be nominated because it should be nominated. She's like this 90-year-old Korean woman. She's absolutely hilarious. She's fantastic in this movie. And then fifth is Oscar winner Olivia Colman. I haven't seen this movie. Nobody has seen this movie yet. It's The Father. I don't know. It's apparently really great. I have no idea. Anyway.
They're always that one Oscar movie that's getting a lot of buzz, but nobody's seen it.
It doesn't come out till March 26th. What? How is it still eligible for Oscars this year when it comes out March 26th? Anyway.
There's plenty of good movies this year. Like, it's not a 2019 year where you had like just banger after banger.
There were bangers last year.
2019 was insane. Like, it was of the years to pick, you're gonna get a bunch of free movies. I picked a great year for that.
There were a lot of great movies in 2019. Anyway, on to Best Actor, which is the biggest runaway of the whole thing. There is absolutely no doubt, bet your entire life on Chadwick Boseman winning Best Actor for Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. This thing is locked up, sealed, over. He is absolutely going to run away with this. Second place, Anthony Hopkins for The Father. Again, nobody has seen it. It's apparently great. Anthony Hopkins is great. It's cool that he and Jodie Foster are both nominated in the same year. Silence of the Lambs, great movie. Go watch it. Anyway, then third, Riz Ahmed for Sound of Metal. Great performance.
Hold on. Quick statement here. Eugenics is a little close to eugenics. Just saying.
True. So then fourth, Steven Yeun for Minari. He's great in it. And then fifth, Gary Oldman for Mank, which, again, not a very good movie, but Gary Oldman also not great in it, but he's Gary Oldman, so he's gonna be nominated.
Oldman's.
So on to Best Actress, which is of all the four acting categories, the one I'm most confident in the five that are gonna be nominated, which are Carey Mulligan for Promising Young Woman.
Amen.
Frances McDormand for Nomadland. The shocking Golden Globe winner, Andra Day, for The United States versus Billie Holiday. Viola Davis for Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. And Vanessa Kirby for Pieces of a Woman.
Amen.
Then for Best Director, another category that I think is pretty close to locked up, for Chloe Zhao for Nomadland.
Wow.
She's going to kind of run away with this. Then David Fincher for Mank. Fincher. Again, his worst movie.
Thank dang.
Aaron Sorkin for The Trial of the Chicago 7, which I don't get. I thought that was a very blandly directed movie, but he's going to be nominated.
Because Aaron Sorkin.
Yep.
This is what this year is.
Yep. And then
a lot of his movies are, oh, that guy's famous, so let's nominate him.
It's the same thing with Mank, with David Fincher. David Fincher is the one who directed Social Network, Fight Club, Seven, like,
honestly,
full-time director, but
honestly, a little bit, it's a Meryl Streep. It's kind of like Meryl Streep. Like, sometimes she'll be in a kind of average movie and she'll still get nominated.
Yeah. She was nominated for Into the Woods, which I like Into the Woods. It's a good movie. She gives a good performance. She's in it for like 3 minutes.
If Meryl Streep was in a Marvel movie, she'd probably get nominated.
Probably, honestly.
Matt, put it on the poll. Two things, actually. First, would Meryl Streep ever do a Marvel movie? And then number two, if Meryl Streep did a Marvel movie, would she get nominated for an Oscar and have a good chance of winning?
I will say, up until, I never thought it was possible for Meryl Streep to be bad in a movie until I saw Mary Poppins Returns, and she is awful in that movie. She is really bad. Next, for Best Director, Emerald Fennell for Promising Young Woman, who I think should win this. I think Chloe Zhao is very worthy, but I think Emerald Fennell should win. And then Lee Isaac Chung for Minari will be, I think, the fifth one. And so then on to Best Picture. Nomadland is a lock for being nominated. Trial of the Chicago 7 is also a lock for being nominated. I think Minari is a lock for being nominated. Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, One Night in Miami, Mank, Promising Young Woman. Now, I think those seven are all pretty much locks to be nominated. Then you've got Judas and the Black Messiah, Sound of Metal, and then Matt, are you ready for it?
Yes.
Because here it comes. Borat.
Subsequent movie film, delivery of prodigious bribe to American regime for make benefit once glorious nation of Kazakhstan.
I am saying it right now. That movie is getting nominated for Best Picture. It actually will get nominated for Best Picture. Yes, so those are those. And then I'm going to just run through the Oscula real quick because I don't think we've handled it on the show.
Okay.
Oscula is a mathematical formula to predict Best Picture nominees and eventually the winner. Nomadland is completely running away with it, has an average of 8.1. The next closest is Trial of Chicago 7 with 6.8. Then you've got Minari, Mank, Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, Promising Young Woman, The Father, One Night in Miami, Judas and the Black Messiah, Sound of Metal. Now that is the cutoff for movies that would be nominated. Then you've got Borat 2, or
Borat. I'm not. I closed the tab.
Yep. And then
Hold on, real quick. Our two most. I don't know if you guys heard that. I farted. Do you bring your own food to Benihana, or do you realize it's an actual restaurant with yes or no as the choices? No, it's the most voted on poll so far. Followed by our Frank Thomas and his Nugenics gonna steal your wife, and somebody voted no on that. I don't know who voted no on that one. Like, literally the entire commercial is that these women are jealous that Frank Thomas is jacked and on his Nugenics while their man is behind Frank Thomas, who is built like a literal god at his current age. Also, I find it funny that Frank Thomas didn't take steroids, but his male enhancement product does amazing. But again, he was a pure player.
Watch Frank Thomas on Fox Sports.
He's very good. He's good at
movies, because I got music to talk about.
Yeah, go for it.
I'm just going to finish up these. Which are so the just below being nominated are Borat subsequent movie film, Soul, The Five Bloods, News of the World, Pieces of a Woman, Mauritanian, which is a new addition to it. It was getting nominated for too many things to keep out of it, so I had to throw it in there also. Then The United States versus Billie Holiday, The Prom, Palm Springs, Tenet, and Lowly Little Music, which is sitting there at an average of 1.6. So.
You said Tenet?
Yeah, Tenet has 2.5%, or 2.5 average. So it has no chance. I didn't care for it.
But What's-His-Face said you had to see it in theaters.
I saw it in theaters. I still didn't care for it.
What's the director? Cameron? James Cameron?
Oh, Christopher Nolan directed.
Same person. Put it on the poll. James Cameron and Christopher Nolan the same?
It really, honestly, not a bad poll.
Who's the director of the Transformers? Is Michael Bay the beer league version of James Cameron?
I'm putting that one on the poll. Is Michael Nolan the beer league?
Michael Bay, the beer league version of James Cameron and Christopher, or Christopher Nolan?
Yeah, he really is, especially of James Cameron. Christopher Nolan is kind of up his own, you know, whatever. James Cameron does just make like stupid, like dumb action movies. It's just they're really, really good. Like the Terminator, the first two Terminator movies are incredible. I went back and watched them like last week because I was like, I'm in the mood for Terminator, and James Cameron directed those first two. Those movies are amazing. Like they're so good, but they're also like such dumb action movies. Like they're great.
This is Michael Bay. This is Michael Bay's cinematic like vision. He says, okay, crappy movie here. We know it's bad, but it's gonna be good if we add attractive girl and explosion.
Yeah, Michael Bay movies are attractive girl in skimpy clothes sitting on a bike, like 30 shots of the American flag, like a bunch of like shots where he like circles around the actors and stuff like that, and then a ton of slow-mo action.
Like, that's like a it's like, what was that terrible first one with Mark Wahlberg?
Oh, God,
it was terrible. I think it was Age of Extinction.
Pain and Gain?
No, Age of Extinction with the first Mark Wahlberg.
Oh, Age of Extinction is awful. I didn't even make it through that whole thing.
Oh, it was so bad. Like, it was just a terrible movie trying to be masked by how many damn explosions there were.
The Bad Boys movies are the only Michael Bay movies that aren't terrible, just because, like,
Transformers is tolerable.
It's okay. But like the first two Bad Boys movies know that they're ridiculous and crazy, and they just rely on Martin Lawrence and Will Smith to like be entertaining, and they're actually like not that bad. But other than that, they're all awful. Because
Martin Lawrence and Will Smith have some talent.
Yeah, and then Bad Boys 3, which wasn't directed by Michael Bay, ended up being the best one in that series.
You think it's the best one?
Yeah, I enjoyed Bad Boys 3. I thought it was pretty good. All right. By the way, it has a great cameo by Michael Bay.
All right. It's music time.
Yes.
All right, Matt. You go for it. I am going to be listening from the potty.
Oh gosh, I'm gonna start by playing the clip of the song I had referenced, and tell me, again, the title is called "If You Seek Amy." Now listen closely, because you may or may not hear it said that way. So here's the chorus.
Okay,
you get that? All of the boys.
I got it. I got it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to see if Jesse can catch on to it though, because I get it. But
she
really spells it out for you.
She spells it out for you. She says it a few times, even though one of the lyrics actually she says Amy. Like, just out of reference, because, I mean, look, you realize that's what the song's about. What the music video is great, though, because it makes fun of Fox News, because Fox News actually made fun of the song, and it kind of just is sort of the metaphor for the life that everyone thought she lived, and the life she knows she lived, aka with cameras in her face. All right, Grammys. I will be honest with you, I don't listen to a ton of who they nominate, but I'm going to go through just the four big categories. I'm going to start with Best New Artist. Your nominees this year are Ingrid Andress, Phoebe Bridgers, Noah Cyrus, Chica, D-Smoke, Doja Cat, Kaytranada, and Megan Thee Stallion. First of all, I did a promo for a Doja Cat concert for Blaze Radio back in 2018. Which is a very cool thing. And, if she wins this category, I might have to find it and tweet it out, because it's pretty awesome that I voice tracked a promo for a show for her. Who I think will win is Megan Thee Stallion. She's, I would say, the most popular out of the group. I can see it going to Phoebe Bridgers, but I think Megan Thee Stallion.
Play it again. I didn't understand it.
I'm going to go through the picks, and then I'll play it to close my window out. So Megan Thee Stallion's going to win Best New Artist. Now, Song of the Year. Your nominees are Black Parade by Beyonce, The Box by Roddy Ricch, Cardigan by Taylor Swift, Circles by Post Malone, Don't Start Now by Dua Lipa, Everything I Wanted, Billie Eilish, I Can't Breathe by Her, and If the World Was Ending, J.P. Sachs and Julia Michaels. I've never heard of Black Parade. I'm sorry, I really stopped listening to Beyonce music. The Box is eh. Cardigan is eh. Circles was highly overplayed on the radio. Everything I Wanted is okay. I Can't Breathe by Her, haven't heard. I would assume it's a very emotional song.
Guitar.
If the World Was Ending is such a, was such a terrible song to come out while everyone was in quarantine, my pick for song of the year is Don't Start Now by Dua Lipa.
Don't Start Now.
All right. Here again, I didn't list most of these albums. I didn't listen to, and maybe if I know any songs by them, I don't know. So the nominees are Chilombo by Jenny Aiko, never heard of it. Black Pumas by Black Pumas, never heard of it. Everyday Life by Coldplay.
Wait, they have a song? Oh, no, 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 it's album. Okay, I was about to say they have a song about called their name. It's bad. It's yeah, album, so I got you.
DeJesse, I mean, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but it's DeJesse Volume 3 by Jacob Collier. Never heard of it. Women in Music Part 3 by Haim. Future Nostalgia by Dua Lipa. Hollywood's Bleeding by Post Malone. And Folklore by Taylor Swift. I could see any of the last four, Haim, Dua Lipa, Post Malone, or Taylor Swift, winning that album of the year. Because they're in previous years recently that they've been consistent about giving out like three awards to the same person out of these general categories, I'm picking Future Nostalgia by Dua Lipa, which leads us to Record of the Year. Again, Record of the Year, Song of the Year, two different things. Song of the Year, I think they look more into the words and the songwriting. Record of the Year goes into like all the instrumentals and whatnot. Your Record of the Year nominations are Black Parade by Beyonce, Colors by Black Pumas, Rockstar by DaBaby featuring Roddy Ricch, Say So by Doja Cat, Everything I Wanted by Billie Eilish, Don't Start Now by Dua Lipa, Circles by Post Malone, Savage by Megan Thee Stallion featuring Beyonce. Who could win in this category? I think Savage is a huge song. I think has a shot. Honestly, Rockstar has a good shot winning too. Circles, Everything I Wanted. I think Dua Lipa is going to get a three category sweep. Don't Start Now is going to be Record of the Year.
Wow. All right. Will be very happy.
All right. I will depart after playing the Britney Spears again.
Okay.
You still don't get it?
She really spells it out for you.
If you see blank at me?
No.
If you seek Amy.
If you seek Amy.
Oh, now I got it.
Get out the video. I gotta go.
Alright. Alright, Max. I have one more thing I want to talk about. It's more serious. I don't know if... Do you have a What Are We Doing? Or do you just want to talk about it?
Go ahead.
Myers Leonard. It's really bad because I don't know if... unbeknownst to him, I don't know if he knew this or recognized this, but maybe his biggest fan in the world is Jewish. One of our friends. I have a lot of friends that are Jewish.
And just like going like even bigger than this also, like Miami is a pretty
big
Jewish
community. Yes.
I mean.
Yes, that is 100% true. And so, yeah, I think that, he said that pretty casually. So that's all I got to say.
Well, here's the issue. I'm not sure he said it casually. And I think that's the issue. I think he
casually by the terms of like he said it before.
Yeah, like he thought about it.
Yeah. So bad. It is bad. And he should lose his job, I think.
I did see one thing that was really concerning. I don't know if they've corrected it, but NBC Sports wrote an article about it. And their headline included like other words that he said during the stream, including, if you seek Amy, including that and stuff. and it starred out like censored the other words, but didn't censor the slur. Which
they gotta change that.
Was not a good look for NBC Sports at all.
Yeah, they gotta change that.
I don't know if they did change it. They could have. I saw that a few hours ago, so that might have changed. But that was a big issue I saw also with that.
Yeah, but it's not good. And it really sucks. And I'm sure that our Miami Heat fan friends are upset about it. I haven't gotten the chance to talk to them about it yet. I was hoping that Jeremy would be on to talk about it, but he's not. So I'll just ask him off there. It sucks too, because I've also met Myers Leonard with her, and he seemed like he was really cool. Mm-hmm. So, and I just hope that, again, like, I he needs to lose his job, but I hope that it means that he grows from it. And that's the thing. I'm like, I think that canceling is such a loaded term. So, I think we need to change it to, Myers Leonard needs to be educated. Mm-hmm. Myers Leonard should be canceled. Like, Myers Leonard needs to be educated. That's the better way to do it. But let's get back to the polls. And let me read them off real quick. Not too many votes, but we've been picking up some steam late in the show. So is Michael Bay the beer league version of James Cameron and Christopher Nolan? 100% yes. If Meryl Streep did a Marvel movie, would she get an Oscar nomination and be likely to win? 67% yes. Would Meryl Streep do a Marvel movie? 100% yes. It's not true. Is there that one Oscar-nominated film that gets a lot of buzz, but nobody has seen it? 100% yes. Jeremy is winning with 100% on Symbol. Or Jeremy's musical instrument would be Symbols, 100%. It's got one vote, though it's me. Are Frank Thomas and his eugenics going to steal your wife? 60% no. Do you bring your own food to Benihana, or do you realize it's an actual restaurant? 100% no. Okay, that'll do it for this week's alumni show. I'd like to thank Max and Kling. And of course, we are going to say good night to our friends north of the border. Good night, Canada.